In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgression unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil, and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill toward. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord of all power and might,
author and giver of all good things, graft into our hearts the love of your name, increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and of your great mercy, keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The first lesson for the sixth Sunday after Trinity is written in the book, second book of Moses, known as Exodus, chapter 20. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm of the day is Psalm 19. The congregation is invited to sing the refrains of the psalm after it's introduced the first time.
Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. 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 The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The rule of the Lord is to be trusted, giving wisdom to the simple. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. The precepts of the Lord are right, delighting the heart. The command of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eye. The fear of the Lord is holy, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are true, all of them just. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. Lord, you have the words of everlasting life. They are more precious than gold, than the purest of gold, and sweeter are they than syrup or honey from the comb. Lord, you have the words of everlasting.
The second lesson is written in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 6. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin, how can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory be to you, Lord.
Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. I tell you the truth, until the heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, do not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to his brother, Raca, is answerable to the Sanhedrin. But anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly with your adversary who is taking you to court. Do it while you are still with him on the way, or he may hand you over to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you may be thrown into prison. I tell you the truth, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you from God the Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus. If you want to go to heaven, do you need to keep the Ten Commandments? Be careful how you answer that. If someone says no, then you have to ask, well, then why did he give them? Was he joking? Was he not entirely serious? Do they not apply to you, or do you think that they are not commandments but mere suggestions? On the other hand, if you say yes, then we might well ask, well, what do you need Jesus for then? And did he die on the cross for nothing? We may think that the commandments don't apply as much anymore, or we might think that Jesus did away with some of them, or that God really wants us to keep them, but he'll understand if we don't, and he'll probably just let us in anyway. But the truth is that it doesn't really matter what we think, but what God thinks. And so today we listen to Jesus, what Jesus thinks about the law and the commandments of God, how they apply to us, how they apply to him, and how he applies to us. Jesus did not come to abolish the law. The law is God's unchangeable and eternal will for us, and it's summed up in the Ten Commandments. Jesus did not come to wipe it out or to make it optional. No, Jesus says, in fact, he says, not a iota, not a dot, not the smallest little mark will pass from the law until it is all accomplished. That is finished, fulfilled. That means that the law must be kept down to the very last dot. And entrance into heaven depends upon it. Jesus says, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, it's not uncommon for us to compare ourselves, our righteousness, with others. Usually, though, we compare ourselves to those who are less righteous, because we can always find someone not quite as good as us. But Jesus says, if you're going to compare yourself to others, then you should compare yourself to the most pious, law-abiding, upright, all-around nice people that you know. In Jesus' day, those were the scribes and Pharisees. You have to be better than them, more righteous than them. That also means that the righteous scribes and Pharisees weren't good enough either. And so to help us see this, Jesus uses an example. He starts with the fifth commandment, you shall not murder. And we say, well, that's an easy one. I've never killed anyone. And so we feel pretty good about ourselves. But Jesus says, not so fast. For the heart of the commandment, as it turns out, is the heart. Murder doesn't start in the hands or in the weapon, but in the heart. The core of sin is in the sinful heart, and it starts with things like anger and hate and everything in between, including the angry words that you speak, including the grudges that you hold on to even when you come to church. And Jesus says that the same punishment belongs to the crime in the heart as the crime committed by the hands. Which means that your wicked, grudge-bearing, angry hearts deserve just as much punishment as someone who slits the throat of children. God is furious with sin, including sin in the heart. And that's just 1 out of 10. We could go on. We could move to commandment number 6. And if it were known what lustful thoughts and dirty words and nasty deeds have been done in the darkness against God's gift of marriage, most of you would never dare show your face in public again for shame of your sin. 7. What God calls stealing, we call cleverness. 8. We claim that it's not gossip if it's true. We could keep on going, but I think you get the point. The commands of God, Jesus says, most certainly apply to you, and it applies to more of you, that not just your hands, but your head and your heart as well, more of you than you are even aware. Then here comes Jesus. And if Jesus did not come to abolish the law, well, so that, and make it so that it doesn't apply to us, well, then Jesus must have come to help us keep it then, right? Well, no, he doesn't say that. He says that he came to fulfill the law, not to help you fulfill it. The law still applies to you as you are. If anything, Jesus makes it harder because he makes us know just how impossible it is. For otherwise, we would think that with just the right program, just the right steps, or just the right amount of discipline or instruction, we should be able to do anything that we put our minds to. But the law doesn't work like that. Rather, he gives it, and he applies it even more strongly to allow you to see where the law leads. Jesus lets you, and he wants you to see the real consequence of your sin. Where does it lead? Anyone with murderous anger in his heart is subject to judgment. The one who puts hate on his lips is destined for hellfire. The one who refuses to reconcile with his brother will pay every penny for all eternity. He wants you to see that keeping the law is plainly impossible. Even if you look on a Sunday morning like the most shining example of a Christian man, woman, boy, or girl, at the very best, then you're at the level of the scribes and the Pharisees. But that's not good enough. So as it is, the law leads you to judgment, and it leaves you in hell. So that there, you will see how the law applies to Jesus. See, Jesus did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. He's the only one to fulfill all of God's law, the only one to truly love God with all his heart, to love his neighbor and his enemies as himself, the only one to actually reconcile with his brothers, Father, forgive them, before bringing his offering to the altar of the cross, where he came before the judgment seat of God, bearing all the world's iniquities, facing the fires of hell for the sins of another. Suffered, died, and buried, we say. Jesus preaches the law so that you'll see that breaking the law, your breaking of the law, ends up in judgment and hell, that the law most definitely applies to you, but that on the cross, that very same law and that very same judgment, all of your sins against it were there applied to Jesus, not to you. Don't you know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? In other words, Jesus was applied to you. His suffering, his death, his punishment, his judgment is poured out on those baptized into his name. And what's more, his righteousness, the only righteousness that is actually greater than that of the scribes and Pharisees, the only righteousness that avails before God, clothes you like a white robe. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. New life indeed. This is your life now. So that whole question about needing to keep the Ten Commandments to get to heaven, it's really a bad question. For through your baptism, the perfect keeping of the Ten Commandments has already been applied to you. You've already done it. The perfect, innocent sufferings of Christ for your sins has been applied to you. Since Christ has obeyed, fulfilled, accomplished the entire law of God in our place, on our behalf, God doesn't need you to keep the commandments. But your neighbor does. Your neighbor needs your keeping of the commandments. Because, for example, God has given your neighbor his body and life. And he's given you to protect it in the fifth commandment. God gave the gift of marriage, and he gave you to honor it with a pure and decent life and love and respect in marriage. God gives possessions, and he gives neighbors to help each other keep them. He gives a good name and reputation, and he gives neighbors to help each other to keep it. When you fail in this, and you will, it's back to the font you go, not to be rebaptized, but back to Jesus, back so that the law can kill us and drown us again, so that the gospel can bring us again to new life. It's back to the altar, again and again, to be connected to Christ Jesus by receiving in your own mouth his own body and blood, back to the confessional, back to hear Jesus' own words from the mouth of his servant, "I forgive you." Understand, if you think you don't need any of that, then you can deal with the law on your own, because it won't go away. Not ever. Not a bit of it. If you want to hide your sin behind your Pharisaical piety and pride and pretend that like you have no sin simply by not talking about it or always acting like you've got it all together, then take heed of Jesus' warning. You will not enter the kingdom of heaven. But Jesus has come. Jesus has come not to abolish the law, but to be your fulfiller of it. He has come that the law and all of its consequences might be applied to him. And he comes finally to you that he might be applied to you. If you want to go to heaven, the commandments aren't your ticket. Jesus is. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join together in confessing the Christian faith with the Nicene Creed.
not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with your free Spirit. Amen.
To their needs. Heavenly Father, hear the voice of our pleas for mercy. Your law is good and wise, but we confess that we have not kept it. Forgive us our sins. Help us to do better and keep us united to Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who fulfilled the law and the prophets, that we might remain clothed in his righteousness, which exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, you provide earthly government to restrain evil and promote good in our world. Bless our president, our governor, and all who make and administer our laws, that they might serve with integrity and honor, and that our nation, which celebrates its independence this week, would remain committed to the principles of liberty and justice for all. Lord, in your mercy,
our prayer.
Loving Father, it is out of your love and wisdom that you provide us vocations in which to work and serve. Give us joy in our vocations, whatever they may be, and fill us with your Holy Spirit that we would strive to be faithful and diligent in our work and service for the benefit and blessing of our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, hear those who cry out to you for help in their time of suffering. According to your gracious will, heal their infirmities or give them strength to bear all their crosses in Christian patience. Above all, sustain them in the faith, that they would be comforted in the forgiveness, life, and salvation they have in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Father, bless those who come to the altar this day to receive the gift of your Son's very body and blood for the forgiveness of their sins. Through this holy sacrament, strengthen and preserve them in body and soul into life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for all the faithful who have gone before us in the hope of eternal life through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and now rest from their labors. Sustain us in that same hope of eternal life through Christ, that we would join them in the feast that never ends when Jesus returns in great glory on the last day. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, you have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. You lifted Noah and his family in the ark. You promised to bless all nations through Abraham. You delivered Moses and the Israelites. You renewed your promises through the prophets. And now you have spoken through your Son, who in words and deeds proclaimed your kingdom and was obedient to your will. In your tender mercy, you gave him your one and only Son, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. By the one offering of himself, he made there a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Therefore, gracious Father, remembering his blessed passion, mighty resurrection, and glorious ascension, we humbly thank you for this wonderful gift of salvation through your Son's own body and blood. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of this Holy Spirit, all glory and honor be yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Taught by our Lord in trusting his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever.
We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this Holy Supper. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Maybe seated. Just a quick announcement. If you didn't get a chance to pick up a copy of the bulletin, the announcements, and the devotion sheet, those were standing on the credenza by the communion registry sheet. They'll be there. That's the plan. On your way into church, you can pick those up. On your way in, the ushers, the elder, will have the ordo for the day. In there, you probably saw it. We'll be going on vacation here. If anyone is in need of pastoral care, during my absence, you are free. You can call me. I'll still have my phone and contact. You can send me a message or a phone, and I can contact a pastor in the area if you're in need, or that has Pastor Schreiner, his contact information there in the bulletin as well. God be with you.